First up, as a result of the internet, newspapers are finally going really tough, especially when trying to attract younger readers. There's been a fall of over 16% over the last 10 years, and many publishers have actually had to rethink their whole business models. So a similar story for TV. The number of genuine mass program transmissions has declined sharply in the last decade. In 97, there were 185 programs with 15 million plus viewers, and by 2005, there were none. Against that kind of background, pretty obvious, the internet usage is booming, and it's just going to increase as broadband opens up more applications for consumers and businesses, and really internet moves, kind of beyond search into sort of entertainment and kind of social interaction. But understanding how consumers are searching for products, and most importantly, the timing of these searches, can help businesses really maximise the opportunity via their marketing campaigns. A good example of this is UK searches for UGG boots overtook searches for Crocs in the middle of September. There's no accounting for taste, but if you were a retailer, this information would be incredibly valuable, ensuring that both your inventory and your search marketing campaigns are totally in tune with the consumer's needs. Taking it a step further, when you actually look at how people are buying products, and this applies to services, consumer, and kind of B2B space, the internet is becoming more and more influential. Look at the kind of discovery, the compare, the final checks, and then people actually want to feel good about their decision by sharing it with others and really getting that kind of recognition and sort of validation. And this is really important when you consider that a happy customer can potentially become a really powerful advocate for your business and your products. And on the flip side, an unhappy customer can share their experience with millions at the click of a button. So internet-based communication tools like blogs, podcasts, wikis, social networks really have enabled customers to have their own voice and their collective opinion in a way that wasn't previously possible. You can't just look at it as social networks, blogs, news groups. You actually have to understand what's different about them, what's different about the people that use them, and then prioritise who you're targeting and how you're going to target it. So it's really back to basics. And a lot of that, really sound business thinking kind of goes out the window when you get into the digital space and people just kind of exaggerate the benefits. And now I'm just going to pull out an example of the commercial significance of some of these emerging social media players. I mean, just take MySpace as an example. There's 170 million accounts. If it were a country, it would be the 11th largest in the world, and that's in between Japan and Mexico. So we're talking significant numbers here. But the really key thing from a commercial perspective is after search, MySpace sends a huge amount of traffic to the UK's top e-commerce sites. After Google, MySpace is number two for sending traffic to retailers such as Argos and Topshop. The traditional boundaries between media are blurring. I mean, a newspaper is already not just news, and it's certainly not just a paper. Turning our attention to kind of the business audience, blogs can be a really, really useful source of intelligence. Very often a story breaks first online and then it makes its way into mainstream media. The Google acquisition of YouTube is a good example of that. So how do you actually develop a digital media strategy? How do you actually take on board all these changes and then develop a sort of balanced and effective communications plan? First and foremost, just listen before you participate. This is kind of our kind of mantra. And now I just want to leave you with some pointers that I found really helpful when I've been trying to encourage my teams and people I work with to get more digitally involved. Go to people within your company that are enthusiastic about it. It could be the guy that's doing work experience. If he's totally connected into it, make use of it. And I think you really, really will see the results.
Steve, I've got a question for you. There's obviously a lot of PR opportunities, lots of things out there. I'm an owner of a small business. Where do I start?
That's a really good question. And sometimes I think it can seem so vast and things change so quickly. I mean, the list of actual companies and sites we've heard today is probably, you know, over 100 long. So how do you actually go about working it out? I would say you've got to have a methodology and a process. It sounds dull and dry, but if you don't have one, you will end up just spending days surfing the internet and weaving around sites and not really having a framework to put all the insights onto. So I would go back to basics. You know, what do you do? What are your goals? You know, what do you want to achieve? Then you look for the customer insight, and then you use the mix of the objective and subjective measures, you know, traffic, what they're talking about, the conversation, and you boil it down. And then you just take small steps to building up relationships with them. Don't leap in off the deep end on community networking sites. Find someone that's influential to your business, that your customers go to, start building up relationships with them. And then you can just scale it, and you'll learn a hell of a lot just within that first month of reaching out and talking to people.